So what I'm going to do today is give an overview of the microbiome, and I was asked at the outset to put some emphasis on C. difficile associated disease, and that will come in the latter part of the talk. Now, along the way, I will also highlight some practice points which I hope will be of some help to you in your clinical practices. So what is the microbiome? Well, strictly speaking, the microbiome is the totality of microorganisms and their collective genetic material present in or around the human body or another environment. And of course, for us as gastroenterologists, the only environment that matters is the GI tract. So basically, it's microorganisms and their genomes. Now, there are many other terms out there, which includes microbiota. Now, what's the difference between microbiome and microbiota? Well, microbiota, strictly speaking, refers just to the microorganisms. All of the microorganisms, bacteria, archaea, etc., present in a divine environment, whereas the microbiome is the microorganisms plus their genetic material. The metagenome is a collection of genomes or genes from members of the microbiota, and metabolome is the metabolic products of the microbiome. So there's a whole new vocabulary there that can be very confusing, and in fact, even experts often use some of these words interchangeably. Now, why has there been this explosion in the interest in the microbiome? In fact, if you look back on history, the importance of bacteria in our health has been recognized for a long time. But why have we suddenly seen this profusion of papers, and interest in the lay media? Well, it's largely a technical reason, and it's the arrival of molecular methods which allow high-throughput sequencing, now advancing into metagenomics and metabolomics, and coupled with this is a whole new science of informatics which is capable of interpreting these very complex data sets. So we've gone a long way. We've moved from the old days that we all did in medical school of plating and counting and identifying organisms on a plate to these high-throughput methods which can identify the entire genomes of a given sample from anywhere in the GI tract. Now, there are a whole variety of techniques out there which are hard to follow, and I don't claim to understand them, but some of the most commonly based methods are based on taking a stool sample, extracting total bacterial DNA, and then amplifying this particular area, the 16S sequence. And the reason this is of great interest is that it's present in all bacteria, but it varies between bacterial species. And then using this, you can use a variety of techniques to either define what's there or what their genetic material is. Now, this is my attempt for my own use to put this in the simplest way possible. So how do you interpret these methods? Well, high-throughput sequencing basically tells you what's there. If you use metagenomic techniques such as shotgun sequencing, that will tell you what their genetic material is and could, of course, predict their functions and what they could do. If you move on and you add metabolomics or metatranscriptomics, then you're actually trying to find out what these bacteria actually produce. Now, for us as clinicians, our main interest, of course, is what is the role of the microbiota in disease. And in fact, there are several examples from gastrointestinal disease and other diseases where there's a well-established role for the microbiota. Obviously, in enteric infections and infestations. An absolutely fascinating example is Helicobacter pylori, which illustrates the complex relationships that can occur between a bacterium and the host. Something I'll focus on later, antibiotic-associated diarrhea, which illustrates what happens when we disrupt the normal microbiome. Small intestinal bacterial overgrowth. And in fact, going back over 60 years, we've known of the importance of the gut microbiota in a very important complication of chronic liver disease, namely portal systemic encephalopathy. And of course, gut-derived organisms are usually of primary importance in the development of spontaneous bacterial peritonitis. Similarly, in biliary and pancreatic sepsis, many of the organisms are of enteric origin. Not a day goes by which you see in the literature another claim for the microbiome as being critical in some disease state, such as reflux disease, functional dyspepsia, diverticulitis, necrotizing enterocolitis in infants, inflammatory bowel disease, ulcerative colitis, Crohn's disease and pouchitis, irritable bowel syndrome, and even in celiac disease. Now, there is evidence in many of these disease states to support some role for the microbiome, but have we actually defined a causative role or a precise causative role? Usually, probably not. And then we move on to a whole variety of other diseases ranging from obesity, metabolic syndrome, diabetes, neurological diseases like Parkinson's disease and Alzheimer's, autism, depression and anxiety, atherosclerosis, colon and other cancers, autoimmune disorders, and the list goes on. And when we stray into some of these areas, we often are moving more into the hypothetical rather than into areas where there's good solid evidence. But there are tantalizing pieces of evidence, largely from animal studies. Now, many of these studies that are referred to, which correlate a change in the microbiome with the disease state, have problems. Firstly, and this is an important issue for us as clinicians, do we actually know what is normal? I would argue that we still do not know what is the truly normal microbiome for a given individual. Many of these studies do not account for diet and other confounders. If you take irritable bowel syndrome as an example, we all know that patients with irritable bowel syndrome are on all sorts of diets. So what we could be seeing in their microbiome is not the effect of IBS or relationship with IBS, but rather the impact of a particular diet. Furthermore, most of these studies are not longitudinal. They're a single point in time, they're a snapshot. And that type of study can show you a relationship, but it by no means can show you causation. They cannot separate state from trait, and also they cannot account for the influence of any particular therapy for that disease state. And then there are sampling issues, which I'll talk about later. Along the way, I will highlight these practice points, as I mentioned at the outset. Now, do we know what is normal? Well, there's been a lot of work done on this. There are large consortia here in the US, in Europe, now in Asia, and throughout the world, looking at large community samples of the fecal microbiome. And yes, we do know a lot. For example, we do know that in normal individuals, most of the bacteria belong to two phyla. These Firmicutes, shown here, and the Bacteroidetes, shown here. They account for the vast majority of bacteria. And if we move down to a genus level, and this consortium, which is the European consortium, suggested that even though there is tremendous variability between individuals, if we look at genus level, there is some clustering of individuals into what they call these three enterotypes, which are driven by these particular genus. And they suggest that whether your Bacteroides, Prevotella, etc., was probably largely driven by your diet. And that brings me to talk in more detail about what influences the microbiome. We know that the microbiome at birth is virtually sterile, though not quite sterile, and over the first 2 to 3 years of life, you rapidly acquire the microbiome that'll be with you for the rest of life. There is some evidence, not convincing as yet, that there may be some change in the microbiome later in life with reduction in diversity. Geography seems to have an effect, but whether this is driven entirely by diet remains unclear. I already mentioned the importance of diet. And then, of course, there are these ubiquitous exposures that we come across in clinical practice, such as antibiotics and proton pump inhibitors. And finally, and extremely important to remember, is that the disease could be causing the change in the microbiome, not the other way around. Now, this is a study which I think illustrates several of these points. This is a study which looked at community individuals in three populations, in the urban US, in the Amazon basin in Venezuela, and in rural Africa in Malawi. And what they looked at was this basically looks at the number of different bacterial species in the sample. And here we're going from age 0 all the way up to age 86. And what you can see is that for each of the populations, and as you can see, the populations are color-coded, you can see a dramatic rise in the number of different bacteria over the first couple of years of life. And then, even though there's quite a bit of variation, it remains relatively stable until later in life. Now, for obvious reasons, for some of these communities, we have very few samples later in life. And this expands at the first three years of life, and you can see the dramatic increase in the number of bacterial species over the first 3 years of life. But here's a very interesting observation. Here they're now looking at comparing the three different populations, the US, the Amerindians, and the Malawians, and you can see that, unfortunately, those living in cities in the US had the least diverse microbiome, whereas those in Venezuela or in Malawi had a much more diverse microbiome, almost certainly reflecting a much more vegetable and fiber-based diet than that the highly refined, highly processed diet in the US. So diet is a major confounder. It's certainly in the long term, there are many, many studies showing that over years, your diet will alter the diversity of the microbiome, and also the diversity of your diet will influence your microbiome, as well as its fiber content and its protein content, and indeed, there's now data for fat and carbohydrate as well influencing the microbiome. But I think one of the new messages here is that in the short term, if you make a sufficiently drastic change in your diet, it will change your microbiome. Now, how about antibiotic effects? They're complex. They will obviously vary by the spectrum of impact of an antibiotic, whether it's broad or very narrow in spectrum. But the big problem with antibiotics, no matter how narrow their spectrum, is that they will influence and impact your normal commensals. We now know that, contrary to what we thought before, antibiotic effects are variable duration. Some antibiotic effects are actually quite prolonged. The other big problem we got to think about is that we can induce resistance through this transferal via bacteria themselves. And also, and I'll show you the data in just a second, antibiotic effects may be evident with very small doses. So here are two studies which show how long-lasting these effects are. These are taken from time zero, again looking at the number of individual bacterial species. You can see here after 7 days of antibiotic therapy, the dramatic reduction, then the antibiotic is stopped, but you still see a reduction for up to 24 months. And this is looking at some important commensals, namely bifidobacteria up on top and lactobacilli in the bottom. These are in different patient populations, and you can see here that those who get antibiotics shown here have a significant reduction in bifidobacteria, though relatively less impact on lactobacilli. Now, this is a study that I mentioned. This is a very interesting study. It is an animal study, and what they've done here is they've tried to mimic the levels of antibiotics that we get through the food chain. As you know, antibiotics are widely used in animal husbandry to increase animal weight. And there is a concern that some of this antibiotics actually gets into our system. But what they've done here is given these very low doses of a whole variety of antibiotics to these animals. And they've seen actually no change in overall body weight, but you can see there's a dramatic difference in their body composition. No matter which antibiotic the animal received, their fat mass increased, their total body fat increased without any change in their lean mass. And this was accompanied by dramatic changes, and you can see here differences between the different antibiotics, but overall they all influenced the microbiome, and was also associated with metabolic changes. Changes in short-chain fatty acid production in the colon, and changes in the metabolism of fatty acids and lipids in the liver. So the bottom line is that, at least in this animal study, that it's possible that very low doses of antibiotics, which we receive through the food chain, can affect our body composition through effects on metabolism and the microbiome. Now, the area of the microbiome that has perhaps grabbed the most headlines recently is this concept of the microbiota gut-brain axis. I'm not going to say a lot about this today because of time, but I think it does open a whole new avenue of potential interactions between the microbiota and the brain. Now, the microbiota gut-brain axis primarily relates to the ability of the microbiota to influence brain and behavior, but we must remember that this is bidirectional, and that the brain can influence the microbiota through effects on physiology, mucin production, etc. So this, like everything else, this is bidirectional. Now, I mentioned sampling earlier, and this actually is a major issue. For obvious reasons, in most studies that are performed, they're performed in fecal samples, particularly when you're looking at thousands of people. But there are some important considerations here. First of all, what location in the gut are you sampling? Are you studying fresh or frozen stool? What technique are you used? And even within techniques, there are a whole lot of implications of precisely how you do the particular technique. And then, how good are your informatics? Now, when we talk about locations along the GI tract, we must remember that the abundance of bacteria varies tremendously in the GI tract. And as we move from the oral cavity to the colon, not only do the numbers increase, but the diversity of bacterial populations increases. And this, of course, is related to the luminal environment, the pH, presence of bile and digestive enzymes, how fast or slow the gut contents transit through that area, very important, particularly in the colon, the PO2 of the area, and also what nutrients are available, because the bacteria rely on the same nutrients that we do. So when we're studying patients with any GI disease, should we sample from the lumen, which is much easier with a fecal sample, or should we also be sampling from the mucosa? And when we look at the anatomy and physiology here, we actually must deal with some particular issues. There is a very thick mucus layer, which we often forget about, and bacteria are contained primarily in the outer mucus layer, with relatively few bacteria on the inner mucus layer. This obviously will have big implications for sampling. This is one study from Yuri Ringel, which showed that there may be clinical implications. This was an IBS study where they compared the composition of the microbiome in stool samples and mucosal samples, and as you can see here, they were significantly different no matter how you measured it. And this is looking at the different phyla, and as you can see, again here, there are significant differences between the stool sample and the mucosal sample. Whether this has clinical implications, as yet, we don't know. Now, for the last part of my talk, I'm going to focus on the gut microbiota and C. difficile-associated disease as an example of the complex interplay between the microbiome and human disease. I don't need to tell you that this is a major clinical problem. It seems to be overwhelming our hospitals. And this is a very important paper on the epidemiology of C. difficile-associated disease. But the important point I want to make here is the appearance of community-associated C. difficile disease. Up until recently, we talked about C. diff purely in terms of its being acquired either in hospital or in nursing homes. Now we see these very significant rates across age groups of community-associated disease. You can also notice that whether it's community-associated or healthcare-associated, we see a very marked age gradient, with the highest rates being in those over 65 years of age. And this is looking at this in tabular form. This is showing how significant the contribution of community-associated disease is to either hospital-acquired, those who acquired it from hospitals but actually were in the community, and those who acquired it in nursing homes. Very significant contribution from community-acquired C. difficile. Now, what are the risk factors for C. difficile? Obviously, antibiotic use. I've just mentioned advancing age, severe underlying illness, being hospitalized, using nasogastric tubes, undergoing cancer chemotherapy, being on immunosuppressants, being on PPIs, and perhaps, and I mentioned this briefly en passant, perhaps your diet. Now, this is a meta-analysis of the PPI story, and this shows that overall, PPIs actually do increase, you can see it right down here, does increase the risk of C. difficile disease. But the risk is relatively small. But interestingly, even though overall PPIs seem to be a risk, when you look at patients in the ICU, which is a very familiar context for us, does not appear to be a significant effect of PPIs. You can see here the probability of being C. difficile free is markedly reduced if you're on antibiotics. If you're on PPIs, less so, and indeed this was not statistically significant. Now, why does this happen? Well, there have been a number of studies, and this is one, which shows that PPIs actually alter the microbiome. This is looking at the diversity of the microbiome, showing that in those who got PPIs, the diversity was significantly reduced. This looks like a small change, but that actually may be clinically significant. This is a very complex slide, but basically, if you look at the blue or the red, that shows you different OTUs which are either increased or decreased in people on PPIs. And what you can see basically, those in gray are unchanged, is that there are many, many bacteria at order, family, or genus level which are significantly altered by PPIs. That this might be clinically important is illustrated in this study, which looked at overall change in diversity and then changes in very specific bacterial species in patients receiving PPIs. And what they saw is that these two taxa, Enterococcacea and Streptococcacea, were significantly increased in those who received PPIs. The importance of this being they have been identified as risks for the development of C. difficile. I mentioned diet, and this is just one study. It's a small study, and it's an animal study, which looked at the influence of the zinc content in the luminal environment and C. difficile. Now, what's the important point here? Well, the important point is that many people get antibiotics, but not all get C. difficile, thanks be to goodness. Now, I've identified some risk factors, but there are people in whom there's no obvious risk factor, so why should they get C. diff? Well, what they showed here was that if you administer excess dietary zinc, you get a much more severe colitis. These are two different C. diff strains. You can see here that the histological score is significantly increased. And this is associated with very dramatic changes in antibiotic resistance. So here is the effect of the control animals, and here is the effect of the antibiotic on C. diff in this high zinc group. Extreme resistances to C. difficile, much more severe disease, and also dramatic changes in the microbiome. This is an experimental study, but at least it brings up the point that changes in your diet may influence your risk for C. difficile-associated disease. I've already mentioned this, but in patients who are at risk for C. difficile, their microbiota is different. And we're beginning to understand the complex interactions between your normal microbiome and the risk for C. difficile. And this involves bacterial metabolism, and particularly involves the influence of bile acids and short-chain fatty acids. And I'll illustrate this in more detail. So if you look at the life cycle of C. difficile, here's your various modes of acquiring C. difficile. The germination of C. difficile is increased in the presence of primary bile acids, decreased in the presence of secondary bile acids. This leads to colonization and disease development with toxin production. Now this looks at it in more detail. So in the normal situation, in the undisturbed microbiota, primary bile acids are transformed into secondary bile acids, particularly by species such as C. cindens. And why is that important? Well, secondary bile acids actually are very effective against C. difficile. Similarly, in the undisturbed microbiota, the commensal microbiome utilizes short-chain fatty acids, and there's very little available for invading bacteria such as C. difficile. In contrast, when you disrupt the microbiome with antibiotics, you shift the balance from secondary to primary bile acids, which are not effective against C. difficile. You destroy a lot of these commensals, and now you've got short-chain fatty acids available for C. difficile and allow C. difficile to proliferate and, of course, ultimately lead to toxin production. And this is showing this in more detail. These bacterial species, such as C. cindens, promote the conversion of primary to secondary bile acids, which inhibit C. difficile. Broad-spectrum antibiotics eliminate species such as C. cindens, therefore reducing the amount of secondary bile acids and promoting the proliferation of C. difficile. Now finally, when we come to therapy in the microbiome, there's a whole range of possible strategies. Diet, obviously, may influence the microbiome beneficially, and this may include the use of prebiotics. I've spoken about antibiotics and their probiotics, prebiotics, synbiotics, and most recently fecal microbiota transplantation. And I'll only say a few words about these largely in relation to C. difficile-associated disease. And this is from a few years ago now, but this has been repeated over and over again, showing that the primary cure rate or the secondary cure rate of FMT is between 90 and 100% in C. difficile. And what happens here is that, and this is shown in detail in this very nice illustration, is that your FMT repopulates the microbiota and changes those balances between primary and secondary bile acids, between availability of short-chain fatty acids that I mentioned earlier, and protects the host. Now, when we look at the microbiome and C. difficile in IBD, it's been noted that IBD patients with C. difficile-associated disease actually have even a more profound dysbiosis. And post-FMT, IBD patients retain more of their original community, are less likely to respond, and more likely to relapse. In post-FMT, those IBD patients who retain more of their original community are less likely to respond and more likely to relapse, and this is shown here. And here you can see here that some taxa that are significantly changed after in IBD patients who received FMT. Now, this is very recent, and this has been a source of controversy, and this is the question, is that can we do anything to prevent C. difficile-associated disease? This is a meta-analysis we very recently published, which looked at 19 studies over 6,000 subjects. In the probiotic cohort, the likelihood of C. difficile was only 1.6% compared to 3.9% in controls, which was a very significant reduction in risk. Probiotics were more effective at giving closer to the first antibiotic dose, with the efficacy falling off with every day of delay of giving the probiotics. And if they're given within 2 days of antibiotic initiation, produced a greater effect. There was no increased risk of adverse effects, and the overall quality of the evidence was regarded as high. So looking to the future, what can we expect? Obviously, we need to move forward here and define microbiota changes that are truly linked to disease. And what's going to be fascinating here, and there are studies going on in this area, is to correlate changes in the microbiota with disease phenotype and with the host genotype. In terms of microbiota and diagnostics, it may help us to define new disease categories, and we're already seeing some hints that it may predict therapeutic responses. We need to refine our therapeutics. For FMT, we need to find out what exactly is working and how can we can tailor FMT to particular disease states. We need more information on prebiotics, probiotics, and the products of bacteria such as pharmabiotics. So in summary, I think there's no doubt that the microbiota is important in health and disease. However, host microbiome interactions in man are complex, and I've illustrated some, and they're far from completely understood. Over and over again, I've emphasized how diet is a major modulator of the microbiome. And I would say that associations with disease are tantalizing, extremely tantalizing. In fact, they may be overly attractive, but it remains to be shown in many instances that they're causal. C. difficile-associated disease provides us with a template to illustrate many aspects of host microbiome interactions and is a well-worked-out example of how the microbiome can influence disease. There are many possibilities for new therapeutics, and I think we can look forward to many exciting prospects in the years to come. And I finally will thank you for your attention.